Beautiful. Wasn't that beautiful? It's so nice to have you back with us, Zach Hart and Jerry Mueller. Thank you so much for that beautiful music. I'd like to welcome all of you to Tridelphia, Seventh Adventist Church. Those of you who are present here this morning and also online through YouTube, we thank you for joining us. And I have just one main announcement. And that is that there are some church positions that were open that we need to present. The board has nominated a number of people to fill these positions, and so this is the second reading. We had our first reading already. For assistant clerk of the church, Sharon Cruz. Thank you, Sharon, for your willingness to serve. Church calendar, Jan Ernson and Aitza Martel. For deacon, we add the name Wayne Harris, and as Sabbath School Superintendent, Nildi Eaton. Is there a motion to accept these names? Okay, second? I have second. So all in favor, say amen.
Amen.
Any opposed? I don't see anyone opposed. Thank you so much. Thank you for, again, all of those who are willing to serve in these positions. There are a number of prayer requests in the bulletin. I just want to draw your attention to those, that we continue to lift them up in prayer. And our Sabbath thought for the day is taken from Ministry of Healing, page 85. It says, "Never feel that Christ is far away. He is always near. His loving presence surrounds you. Seek him as one who desires to be found of you. He desires you not only to touch his garments, but to walk with him in constant communion." To walk with him. He desires us to walk with him in constant communion. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Loving Father, we thank you so much that you are a God who did not wait for us to come to you, but you went seeking for us. And that you desire us to be in constant communion with you. That's our heart's desire this morning, Lord. We invite your presence to be with us. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that comforts us and for your word that guides us. And as we worship you this morning, we ask that you would be very close to each one here present and also those who are watching, wherever they may be. We know that you hear our prayers, and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Our call to worship is Psalm 111. Psalm 111. It's only 10 verses long. And I'll be reading from the King James Version, so I invite you to open your Bibles with me and follow along. Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart, in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation. The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them. His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever. He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. He has given food to those who fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant. He has declared to his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations. The works of his hands are verity and justice. All his precepts are sure. They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness. He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments. His praise endures forever. Amen.
are so blessed in our church because we have so many volunteers working for the church. You know, the elders, deaconesses, deacons, Sabbath school teachers that don't belong to any union to ask for a pay rise. We all work as volunteers in our church. But I'm not sure whether Pastor Sam and Elder Burdick would be willing to go to BGE and tell them, you need to volunteer the expenses for the electric bill. I don't think they would accept that. And we have our chance today of going into our pockets, going into the Adventist Giving app, so that we can give our offerings and our tithes, as today we are going to give it to the church, local church budget. We don't want to be in debt to the power company, to the gas company. And the reading for today talks about debt. And I was surprised when I read what the Chesapeake Conference prepared for the reading for today. It says that Americans collectively owe, back in 2018, about $4 trillion in consumer debts. I tried to put $4 trillion in my calculator, and it doesn't accept that much, that kind of money. Imagine what it is for all of us owing that kind of money. And the Bible has a special verse in the Bible that talks about debt. If we read in Proverbs in chapter 22 and verse 7 says, the borrower is servant to the lender. And we all just want to be servants of the Lord and not of the lender. So I encourage each one of us to remember our local church budget, to remember mission, to remember our church as we put our resources into the Lord's church.
Happy Sabbath, boys and girls. I hope you've had a good week this week, and I hope you have a chance to get out and enjoy the good weather today. You know, today I'm going to talk a little bit about schedules. Maybe if you're in school or about to start school, maybe you've gotten something like this, where it shows the times of the day and the days of the week. This is Theron's schedule for when he starts to go back to class in a couple of weeks, and it shows that, you know, he starts with worship and then Bible, and he's got some writing and math in there. And, you know, it's important because, you know, how does Theron know what comes next? Because his teachers told him, like, this is our schedule. This is an example of his schedule right now before he starts school in person. And it's got where he has different Zoom meetings. So he knows, like, oh, this is the time I need to go dial into my Zoom. Schedules are really helpful. Maybe your family has a calendar that they use. Something like this, where they write important dates on it and where they need to be. My handwriting's not very good, but here you can see this says dog meds. This is the day I need to give my dog his monthly medicine. You know, in our family, we also use on our phones this app that tells us important things we have going on. Like today on Sabbath, it says that Tracy has the children's story and that Tony's gonna preach. And we also have something on every day for family worship. Schedules really help us keep on track. They help us know where we need to be and when. You know, Jesus, there's some pretty interesting stories about how Jesus was always in the right place at the right time. And, you know, I think about the story like the wedding at Cana, where he showed, had his first miracle. And, you know, at one point he said, my time has not yet come. But then when it was time and he turned the the water into juice for the wedding guests. That was a really special thing that Jesus knew just what to do and right when to do it. I wonder how Jesus knew all those important things. Just like, what's another example? Like the woman at the well. When he showed up just at the right time, when he knew she'd be coming to the well in the middle of the day, when no one else would come to the well, and he had a very special story for her and a very special message for her that she took to the rest of her town so that they could learn more about Jesus. How did Jesus know those things? Well, you know, just like Theron knows where he needs to be at different times because his teacher tells him, God, our Heavenly Father, he was Jesus's teacher, just like he's our teacher. And Jesus prayed every day and spent time with God in prayer so he would know right where he needed to be and when. And I'm hoping that you have a relationship with Jesus and God just like that, that you remember that if you're not sure what your priority should be or where you need to be, that you can pray to Jesus and he's going to help you know where to be and when you need to be there. And he'll tell you what you need to do. So remember that just like Jesus, we can pray to our Heavenly Father that he'll guide us and direct us every day. I again hope you have a great Sabbath. And you might have heard my dog barking in the background. He is not where he's supposed to be. He should not have been out there barking when I was telling this story. But, well, that's just how it goes. Happy Sabbath!
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Our scripture reading this morning is found in John chapter 5. And as we heard in our children's story, it shows Jesus being at the right place at the right time with the right person. John chapter 5, verses 5 through 9. I'm reading from the New King James Version. Now, a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me." Jesus said to him, "Rise, take up your bed, and walk." And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed, and walked. And that day was the Sabbath.
Good morning. Welcome, friends watching, friends here, members, visitors. Nice to see you all this happy Sabbath morning. I have good news for you that earlier this morning I shared this message at 8 a.m. and I learned I was a little long-winded, and so I've taken some steps to be a little more brief for your benefit today. We're starting to share about this man in John chapter 5. I thought of the fact that often we are asked, who is your favorite character in the Bible? And people will say Paul or John, other than Jesus, Daniel, Joseph. We hear these names as responses. And I am actually not sure how to answer that question, but I want to tell you that the man we're going to talk about today, the paralytic, would be in the running for me. It's someone I would consider. Before we dig into God's word, I ask that you will bow your head with me for a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for the gift of life, for the fellowship of friends and believers. We thank you for your love. We ask, Lord, now that you will come close to us. I ask that you will help us to put aside the distractions and hear you, not me. Hear your words and not my words, but only, Lord, my testimony as it brings glory to your name. I thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, when I've been reading and studying this book, these verses, John 5, verses 1 through 15, for quite a while, and I found the most difficult thing for me was to try to find a way to narrow down what I wanted to share with you this morning. It's quite difficult. There are many things that come to mind, many applications. That's what I enjoy doing, is seeing like how this fits into my life, because it seems this book, this Word of God, is written exclusively for me, it seems at times. Everything is just to inspire, I can relate to. I think that's true for all of us. I want to try to focus on just three things. And I'm going to begin by reading John chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, to set the stage, the context, which has preceded what Clint just read, which says, John 5, verses 1 through 4. After this, there was a feast of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now there is in Jerusalem by the sheep gate a pool, which is called in Hebrew Bethesda, having five porches. In these lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, paralyzed, waiting for the moving of the water. For an angel went down at a certain time into the pool and stirred up the water. Then whoever stepped in first after the stirring of the water was made well of whatever disease he had. So this sets the context where we are. We're in Jerusalem here. There's a pool here, and there's a gathering of people that are sick in a variety of ways. Paralyzed, just a whole lot of different maladies of life and disease, and they're waiting for what I'm going to just call a superstitious belief, that if the water moved and you were the first one to touch the water, then you would be healed. And the reason I call it superstition is certainly what they believe. That's why they were there. But it's contrary to anything else I find in the Bible. When I read the Word of God, I don't see the same idea. Because what is presented here is if you are the most observant, if you are the fastest, the strongest, the most selfish, then you will be healed. That's what's kind of implied there to me. So I see that as a superstition, as a false teaching. Because Jesus has come here to bring healing to all, not to just those who are the most selfish, right? He does want to bring healing to the selfish, yeah? But not only that, he came to bring healing to us all. So let's read on. I'm going to read verses 5 through 9 because I like to refresh them to my memory, even though I just heard Clint to read them. Verses 5 through 9, now as I continue, it says, "Now a certain man was there who had an infirmity 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew that he already had been in that condition a long time, he said to him, 'Do you want to be made well?'" I love this. We'll get to it more later. But he doesn't answer the question. "The sick man answered him and said, 'Sir, I have no man to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. But while I am coming, another steps down before me.' And Jesus said to him, 'Rise, take up your bed and walk.' And immediately the man was made well, took up his bed and walked, and that day was the Sabbath." Amen. The first thought that I want to share with you is the idea of the efficiency of Jesus. It is not just in this verse, but it is when you look at the ministry of Jesus throughout the Bible, we see different ways that he engaged different people. And we think often about efficiency and what happened with Jesus. We sometimes think of that differently. I can tell you when I think of efficiency, my wife is more efficient than all of you combined. She is the most efficient person I know. She can just in her mind automatically know the solution, the most efficient way to hit all the right places, stores, doctors, I don't know. She could probably go to all the places you need to go more efficiently than you, and she doesn't even know where they are. Not only this, she will do it in the least amount of time. And not only this, if I was to say, "Tracy, but what about this extra thing?" She would say, "Oh, no problem. I will insert it here. And it is the right plan." I'm thinking like, "Well, is that the best thing?" Yeah, she's right. Yeah, okay. My wife is very efficient. She didn't see this coming. But it's true. This is true. I tell only the true stories. Jesus had a different idea of efficiency that we can learn from as his disciples. He does not come out to me in the Bible that he was waking up and saying, "Hey, how do I get from here to Galilee the quickest?" No. He was more like, who do I have to see on the way, right? He had those kind of things. I must go through Samaria, for example. I need to go there. His efficiency was directed by his Father. Because we know from the Bible that he spent long hours in prayer, seeking communion with his Father, saying to his Father effectively, "What do I need to do today? What are we going to do today?" Because his idea of efficiency was furthering God's kingdom, furthering his work in our lives, and restoration to our souls. I think of the fact that he spoke to 5,000. Why didn't he speak to 5,000 every single day in the countryside? Why did he go spend time just with Nicodemus for a little while? Why just Nicodemus? Why not say, "Get the Sanhedrin in here. I'm going to tell you all something about being born again." Why didn't he do that? Because I would say he was efficient in that he started his day with God, his Father. He said, "Father, what are we going to do today?" And we would do well as his disciples to follow the same example. Not wake up and say, "How can I reach the most people?" It might be, "How can I reach the right one person today?" It may be, "How can I reach the most people?" I'm not saying it isn't that. I'm just saying we need God's guidance to know. So we don't hear my wife's sort of efficiency from Jesus, though a blessing it is. We also, speaking of efficiency and Jesus' ministry and his purpose here, we do know in verses 9 through 15, which we're not going to be able to go into this morning, we also know from those verses that this healing took place on the Sabbath. And Jesus could have come to this pool and healed everyone there, right? There are mentions in the Bible of Jesus healing entire villages. So could he not have come to this pool and said, I'm going to take care of all of this. This is quite efficient. You're all right here. I don't have to go to this house and that house. This is very efficient, some might say. But Jesus' ministry, his purpose, was not to come here to bring only physical healing to everyone, though he is able to do this. He knew that his work, from talking to the Father that morning, that his work was to seek and save the lost, to heal this one man, and that that would be the efficient thing to do that day, and it would not slow his work. As followers of Jesus, we need to follow this example and start our day and direct our day as the Father teaches us every day. And what he taught us yesterday can be different today. Maybe yesterday I was supposed to be with this person, but tomorrow I got to be with a different group. So that can be our question, Father, what is best for us, for me to work for you today? Now I want to move on to a second observation or thought that came out in these verses here for me to share with you. And I won't read it again, but I'll say that something that we see on this healing that is a little bit different than everywhere else. I didn't actually read every single miracle of Jesus, but there's some 20 to 30 individual type miracles that Jesus worked. And there's others, depends on how you classify them. But many of them I read all had the idea of faith and people coming to Jesus, and their faith was resulted in the healing. So we know, we've heard these words, you know, the woman who touched his garment, you know, your faith has made you well. The centurion, you don't even need to come take care of my guy, just say the word, it'll be okay. Your faith has made your servant well. Jesus was, the conversations that led to healing seemed to start with faith. In this story, let's back up and say, verse 13 says that the man didn't even know who Jesus was. He didn't know who he was, because later they ask him, who was it that healed you? He's like, I don't know. I just know I could walk. And praise the Lord, right? But I don't know who he is. We didn't have really much of a conversation. He just said, do you want to be made well? And I just got up and walked. And so this man didn't come to Jesus. In fact, Jesus came and sought him out. Desire of Ages, my favorite biography on the life of Jesus, page 202, talks about the fact that this man's situation was the most, I don't remember if it uses the word pathetic, but the most sad. The being a paralytic and by this pool for many years, maybe all of his 38 years, I don't know, was a very sad situation. And God's heart, Jesus' heart, went out to him in compassion. The man didn't come to him. Jesus said, you know, that guy doesn't even know who I am. He doesn't know who I am. But he came over to me, and in my mind's imagination, I like to think about Jesus in different ways, the way he interacted with people. And I can see him going over to this man. It's like, man, his heart's just like, how can I help this man? I want to help. I want to heal this man. I see him getting down on his knee, maybe just sitting down there. And he's probably looking like, who's this guy? I don't know who this guy is. And Jesus doesn't ask about his faith. He just says, do you want to be made well? And so, and the man does exercise faith, does act on what he hears. There's some hope just being around Jesus. Like, there's some hope that I don't have to touch this pool water. This man has something. And he acted on that, and it did change his life. And I'll expand on that a little bit more in a moment. But my point here is that not all healing is the result of us coming to Jesus in the strongest faith, but is somewhat, sometimes, Jesus and his compassion, his love, sees our situation, knows our situation, and comes looking for us, and he wants to heal us. And I love this about Jesus. Let me add the thought that as his disciples, we should be more like Jesus in this way, be more compassionate. I know a person that I would come in contact with different over the years, but other friends, just a group of friends, mutual friends. And we had this one mutual friend that I knew a long time ago, 30 years ago, that made some pretty bad choices in life, and his life was very hard as a result, involved drugs and just difficulty of a difficult life. And I remember when we would get together as friends occasionally, because it's kind of spread out. You know, people would say, hey, did you hear about so-and-so? And we'd say, yeah, and that's sad. That's kind of sad. That's a difficult thing. But you know what I don't think I had, and I think the Lord has worked on me about this, is I didn't have a compassion of like, hey, let me go find that guy. Can I help him? Can I sin? He's made some bad choices. But Jesus didn't judge those choices. He just said, hey, let's go a different direction, right? He didn't sit back and say, yeah, he's got kind of what's coming to him. He didn't do that. He didn't ask the man, hey, why'd you get here? And I think as his disciples, Jesus' disciples, we would do well to do the same thing, to have him change our heart, to see that these things are the result of sin. They might be the result of our choices, but Jesus doesn't care that it's the result of our choices. He wants to change us. He wants to heal us and take us somewhere else. Praise the Lord for a compassionate God. Thirdly and lastly, I want to spend a few moments here. This is a little bit of a difficult thing for me to talk about because it is a very, very personal. And that is that as I relate to this man paralyzed for 38 years, we know from the verses that he was paralyzed 38 years. We know that this took place in about the year 29 AD. That tells me he was paralyzed beginning about 10 BC. So I use my imagination because I'm trying to, so I clarify that. I don't know all these exact facts except what I've said so far. But I kind of look at this and say, well, how can I relate to this man? Have I ever been in this same situation? And so I thought, well, different life stories. Maybe he was born in 30 BC. That means when he was about 20, maybe he made some bad choices, choices of friends or got in some things, maybe some things in his own life, and as a result was in some sort of accident. The Desire of Ages, page 202, I mentioned earlier Desire of Ages, speaks of the fact that his condition was largely the result of his own sin, his own choices, the things he had done. So I use that to say perhaps, I could be wrong, the Lord can straighten this out, but you get the idea that maybe a 20-year-old, maybe 30, I don't know, maybe 15, made some bad choices, was in an accident, his own doing, and had been paralyzed now. So that kind of brings us to this point. Not only that does he have the physical suffering, but he also has, in those days, it was particularly well-publicized idea from the Jewish leaders, unfortunately, and society, that this condition was a judgment of God. Anytime there was disease, leprosy, this is the finger of God touching you. This is why you're in this situation. Now, it may have been in his case, it says in Desire of Ages, maybe it's something he had done. But not only is he paralyzed, can't move physically, but he has the weight of society and shame and guilt of like, I'm here because of my choices. I think that was probably even heavier and harder on him. So if I go back to being born in 30 AD, 8 BC, that makes this man maybe in his late 50s. Could have been 60s, but that helps me relate to it. As I approach my late 50s, not there, I say, this could be me. But like, no, I didn't have an accident when I was 20. And I haven't been paralyzed by a pool for 38 years. No. But as I consider this man, you might think the same thing. No, not me. But I thought, is it possible to consider this, that our lives can be paralyzed by sin? Maybe not physically, but spiritually paralyzed. You may think that this couldn't be you, but maybe this is you. Maybe this is me. Maybe not 38 years ago, maybe 28 years ago, maybe 8 years ago, maybe 8 weeks ago, things happened in our lives that changed our direction, that paralyzed us, that brought some shame, that brought, we made bad decisions. Pain in life comes from a lot of different sources, right? And we deal with pain in different ways. Some of us, pain could be divorce. Bad relationships, divorce or difficult relationships. Pain can come from abusive homes. pain from being betrayed by a coworker. Just, you know, you really trusted this person. And there's just all kinds. Life is full of sinful people who make bad choices and affect other people. There is death and there's loss. Some of us have lost children. Some of us lost spouses. There's loneliness. There's depression. There's a lot of things the weight of sin pushes down on us. And not all of us, I will say for myself, not me, at times in my life have I been so wise as to turn to Jesus. There are things out in the world they offer, like this is the medication. This is the, I like to use the word medication. That could be literally a drug, prescribed or otherwise. That could literally be an addiction to Netflix. I think I shared earlier the fact that I'm not really very familiar with it. I know what it is. But I hear people talk about, some people say, you know, I watched 2 or 3 seasons of something on Netflix this weekend. And now I'm like, that's like a ridiculous waste of time. But I don't even know what it is. And I'm sure it's entertaining. So those laughing, are you the ones who do this? I don't know. But my point is that people go looking for things to escape, to take a break from dealing with who they are, where they've been, the pain in their lives. We turn to lots of things. We turn to social media. You know, if I get enough likes over here, then maybe if my Instagram, that's photos, yeah? Yeah, if photos, Instagram, get enough likes, then, you know, like, you know, I'm okay, right? There's something there. But some of us, we turn to busyness, being busy in work, right? That could be even working at the general conference. Doesn't matter where you work, but you could throw yourself into it because of not necessarily your own doing, but pain in life. I want to just share a little bit that I know about this pain. And some of you know, not many of you necessarily know, but I had a very difficult childhood. I have to choose my words carefully. I don't want to say a whole lot about the details of this, but I had an abusive, physically abusive, this kind of abusive father. And I feel like hit harder, maybe, when under the influence of alcohol or other drugs. And as a result of that, I was a fighting kid. I hope y'all don't see me as a fighter, but I was a violent kid. I fought with people all the time, kicked off the school bus all the time. Later in my 20s, talking to a counselor about some of these things, and I remember the guy, Troy was his name, he said, well, why wouldn't you fight? You know, you're getting beat up all the time, and so you want to beat people up. And it's just a tough, tough childhood for me. And not only that experience, but just my dad had a lot of, he passed away 10 years ago. And maybe I should say this also, that he took an interest in the Lord late in his life. It's a very unusual thing for me to even say this, that when he did pass away, he had written out, he wanted me to speak at his funeral. And I did. And it's a very strange thing as a son to attend your father's funeral and have no emotion, no, I don't even care, I'm just going through the motions. It's just an odd thing, because I see other people and their dads pass, and like, that's more normal. But I went places that no 10-year-old, 12-year-old should go. Saw things that no 10-year-old, 12-year-old, 30-year-old, 40-year-old, 60-year-old should go or see. And that brings about a lot of pain. And I will say that I have made choices of ways to deal with that pain, certainly earlier in my life, even today. That could include, frankly, I'll just say this, that could even just eating. You know, I'm not the healthiest person. The Lord is working on me on that. Praise his name. But I have sought to escape that, right? Not knowing how to deal with that. What do you do with that? I don't know. I'm just a kid. I don't even know what I'm telling you now. Like, I didn't even know then when I was in it. I was just trying to survive, trying to fight. Praise the Lord. The Lord has changed me. I've, since my teens, have not been in any kind of fight. But that's the Lord changing me, right? Because that's who I used to be. People that knew me then, Well, most of them have known me for a long time now and just say, how is this possible? How are you not like, yeah, praise the Lord. So I'm saying that I know something of pain. Not everyone has grown up in difficult situations like that, but some have had difficult relationships, marriages with their children, loss. I've talked about these things before. As a just very brief side note, I had this thought this morning, and I shared it with Fred and a few others this morning for the first time, that Fred Harding is a member here, our head elder, a friend of mine that I cherish greatly. He likes to tell stories, and my favorite stories of his are when he talks about his dad. He tells me just different times. It's not like we sit down and talk about his dad. He just interjects things. And he will say, you know, I remember when my dad, we were painting or building this house, or I had to ride a bike, I wanted a car. My dad gave me counsel about this. And it's like a therapist. Like, it's like I want to lay on a couch. It's like balm. I don't even totally know what that word means. I don't use balm. But it's like soothing to my heart and soul to hear, like, so that's what dads do. It's not that I have never seen them. It's not that he's the only one to tell me that. But something about my friendship with him and hearing about his dad, that it's a gift from God. Yeah, not everybody has that. But, you know, we don't necessarily have to go looking for, I use the word drugs, but things to medicate ourselves, right? And I've certainly done that. But the Lord has said to me, as he wants to say to you, as he does say to you, do you want to be made well? He has said that to me many times. Unfortunately, it wasn't just once. Because I'm like, yeah, I want to be made well, but apparently I don't want to be made well. It seems there at times. Some of you know that I'm very interested in men's ministries here at Tridelphia, also Maryland Men of Faith. We have a conference first Sabbath of October. It's online. Men, you should come to this. And the reason I am sure that I am very passionate about men's ministry is because, is this something good for my dad? It's because of my dad. Let's return to the story. Return to the story, and let's focus on how Jesus, how the man answered the question, do you want to be made well? He doesn't, it's crazy. He doesn't say, yes, I do. Or like, he doesn't know who this guy is. This man just says, do you want to be made well? Instead, he says, well, here's the situation, Jesus, because you're not aware of it. That you got to touch the water. This is how you're healed. I'm going to tell you how you're healed. But I'm at a disadvantage. I cannot get there. I cannot get healing. I think we can answer him the same way. We are wherever we are in life, pain, difficulties, and Jesus can say to you right this moment, I don't know how the Holy Spirit is working here, but he can say, do you want to be made well? And then you say, well, well, I do. Of course I do. That's why I'm at this pool. But Jesus, I don't think you know what I've been through, the choices I've made. I'm here by my own doing, right? I can't blame anyone. Or maybe I can blame someone. It's the most precious thing. Jesus' response to that, I think about this idea of efficiency. When I talked about efficiency, how he was with his time. But he doesn't quibble with us. He doesn't say, oh yeah, Tony, let me explain to you why the pool thing doesn't work. Let me explain to you. No, instead, he tells us to rise up, take up our bed, and walk. I think we can learn a lot from this. Several things occur to me we can learn from this and how he responds to us as well. This man did not physically walk for 38 years, and in a moment, he did. Maybe there are tools in this world that can help us make changes and to be healed. But maybe there are also ways that Jesus wants to say, Let's just go a different direction starting right now. Don't care about why. Don't care about your choices. Don't care about the decisions you made. I don't care that it's your fault. That's not why I'm here. John 3:17, more favorite to me than John 3:16, says, I didn't come here to condemn you. I came to seek and save. It's a precious thought right here that Jesus came there. And so when we find ourselves in this conversation with him, asking us, do we want to be made well? We can waste our time if we want, explaining to him the situation as if he doesn't know, right? He was there in 4 BC, 10 BC, 30 BC, right, when this man was born, as I imagined. I appreciate Jesus doesn't really, and I think he just, what he really tells me there is that has no meaning. The reason, it's not that it doesn't affect you. That's not there aren't effects from sin. Not that there aren't hurts. Those are real things. But the love and compassion of Jesus, I'm going to take you so you're standing up and you're going to start moving a different direction right this minute. He doesn't say a thing about the cause of paralysis. He doesn't say, hey, I know what happened. I know why you're here. He doesn't do that at all. The same is true for us. He doesn't seek to shame us or even hear our excuses. What the paralytic did do was act on Jesus' word. We are familiar with his word. We can be more familiar with his word. And we need not spend a lot of time explaining to Jesus our situation. He knows it better than us. We can't even explain it as well as he could. There's a book called Faith in Works. This man could have spent a lot of time. He could have not gotten up. He could have just said, Jesus, I told you why I can't. You're telling me now to walk. Maybe you didn't hear me. He could have continued. Faith in Works, page 68 says, and actually, I wrote down a paraphrase here, so I didn't quote it. I don't know why I did that. It's very odd. So I'm not exactly sure. I know what my paraphrase was. This is how it struck me. So you can look it up if you like. Faith in Works, page 68 says that if we stop to explain and reason out every point in this conversation with Jesus, we'll never be satisfied. We're looking for some justification. Instead, we need to act on what Jesus has said, and we can be lost in our sins as we just try to quibble, if that is the case. The book From Heaven with Love, page 128, says the man might have stopped to doubt and lost his one chance of healing, but he believed God's word. That's what we need to do. He acted upon it, and he received strength. Through the same faith, we may receive spiritual healing. By sin, we all are exposed to this. We all like some of it more than we would like to say. But by sin, our souls have been severed from the life of God, and we are palsied. We are not capable of living a holy life without Jesus, any more than this man was capable of walking without him. Many who realize their helplessness and long for spiritual life are vainly striving to obtain it. The Savior is bending over us, just like over this man, and he's saying, do you want to be made whole? We're not to wait to feel whole. We're to believe his word and put our will on the side of Christ. In doing so, we will receive strength. Whatever may be the evil which binds our both our soul and body, Christ is able to deliver. So here's the question. Do you want to be made well? Jesus can heal us today. Would you rather discuss with me how long you've been struggling with this? We could do that. But do you want to be made well? Can Jesus make this difference in our lives, your life? Is it any different there? He spoke this world into existence out of nothing. I'm pretty sure he can heal us. Yes, yes. So what can we do right now and today? I think to summarize a few thoughts, we need to remember who Jesus is in the story. Not so much the paralytic, but who Jesus is. He is faithful. He pursues us when we have little or no faith. He pursues us when we are wracked by sin and our choices. He pursues us when we don't even know who he is. He is after us. Remember the compassion of Jesus. Why was he here? Why did he come to this sin-sick world? It's to heal us, to give us a way out. Let's take that way out. Remember, he isn't coming, John 3:17, to condemn us. No matter why you are, where you are, he knows. He knows what you've been through. He isn't, but he's not even wanting to talk about that. That's really not the point of his coming after you, to have you explain to him why you are there. Remember that if you respond to his question, well, I'm just this way, I've always had a temper. You know, I was beat up as a kid. You wouldn't believe that I have the same violent tendencies today. You know, that is clearly the Lord change in my heart. That's just not even in me to swing at anything, baseball maybe, right? I mean, but I'm just saying, like, toward people. But if you knew me as a 10-year-old, as an 8-year-old, as a 12-year-old, a 14-year-old, I am sure lots of people were praying for me back then in the church. Like, can this kid, my mom was always put out by having to drive me to school. It was a long drive, 45 minutes, couldn't ride the bus. I was never allowed to ride the bus. We can go to Jesus and say, you know, but this is what I need. I need this fix to get through this. Jesus wants to fill that place in our hearts. He wants to change our hearts. I don't know if the paralytic of John 5, I started talking about this, is my favorite Bible character, but he is right up there for me. He's higher up there for me than Daniel, Joseph, because I don't relate to Daniel and Joseph in the same way. But God has come to change me so that I can be like Daniel and Joseph. We may not all have the same level of pain. Not everybody's been through kind of a childhood like mine, but people have been through equally more difficult, painful situations. People are in them right now, in relationships or children or spouses or betrayal, things I mentioned earlier. I would encourage us all to turn to Jesus. He's the only one that can make us whole. He can fill that hole that only his love and power can make a difference. I invite you, my closing thought before our prayer is I invite you to read John chapter 5 this afternoon, verses 1 through 15, and prayerfully consider the thoughts shared here. How do they apply to you? Do you need to be more efficient like Jesus? Do you need to be more compassionate like Jesus? Do you need more compassionate to with other people whose situation you don't know how they got there, that you might be more helpful and healing and more like Jesus? And so maybe both of those, but maybe also an opportunity for you to see in this story yourself of how the Lord wants to heal you, wants to change you, and wants to move past all the reasons we are where we are. Please now, if you would, bow your head with me in prayer. Father in heaven, I'm so grateful for who you are, for your faithfulness, for your pursuit of me, for your pursuit of this world, for your pursuit of everyone in the sound of my voice. Even when we are not like you, when we are not compassionate as we should be, when we are not efficient, when we're not willing to surrender our lives to you, when we are making excuses or trying to explain to you why we are where we are. I'm thankful, Lord, that this story shows me that you pursue us anyway. I thank you for your love. Help us, Lord, to surrender to that and to be changed, that we might have life more abundantly today and now. In Jesus' name, amen.